remember special people in space. Congratulations. This was like, you know, like Houston, we had a problem. And, yeah. And we got through successful. I am back into Man on the Moon. Hello to everybody. Hello. Okay. We will land on the moon. My favorite song from Ram, Man on the Moon. Thank you for inviting me, guys.
Yeah, we're welcome. We're happy to have you.
Yeah. It's such an honor to have you. You're such a space icon.
And such an honor to meet someone so special who came all the way from Bangladesh. Very special, very brave, very empowered country. So it's my pleasure to welcome another woman in space.
Yeah, I think that's an important message to empower all women.
And yes, and we have still International Women's Month. Mm-hmm. And we love our guys, our husbands, our boyfriends, our friends. But there is a special reason to have an effort behind Women's Quest. So I introduced a mission of having Interplanetary Women's Month, Interplanetary Women's Month, to pretty much have more, you know, focus on bringing equality to all of us in space. Mm-hmm. And of course on Earth.
Yeah, that's amazing, right?
Yeah, it's pretty cool. Let's give it some more time. I don't know. We probably lost a lot of people when we tried to.
Yes.
Switch to Zoom, but let's give it just a couple more minutes.
Okay. A special guest, all the way from Mississippi, which a lot of us are not aware that state of the Mississippi has the biggest rocket test site in our country.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
Exactly. And this is an untapped opportunity from the standpoint of doing what we started to discuss, California Space Center, which might become Mississippi Space Center, if we drop it next to this incredible location that holds the keys to testing our rockets for the moon. This is where SLS rockets are getting tested. And most of the Americans have no idea. So California Space Center mission now is embracing also Mississippi. Get them, and I will call Eric because yeah. If we will get him talking with you and me, I think we are going to have a great show. Mm-hmm. Hi, Eric. Sorry, we have a technical problems, Houston. We have a problem, but I just sent you a Zoom link. Which works. So we are trying to move everybody to Zoom and would love to have you join us, okay? And we'll talk about Mississippi space and you also, okay? So I just SMS you the link. Great. Okay, wonderful. See you soon. Bye. Call it Houston, we have a problem, but just like Houston, I'm sure Michael is going to charter our rocket to a successful landing.
Yeah.
In the meantime, Ram, Man on the Moon.
Thank you. Eva.
Oh, hello, Eric.
Great. Hello.
Hello, hello. Michael, we have our special guest, Eric Armstrong from Mississippi, that I invited as an example of how we are building space economy together.
Right, that's right.
One state, one city, one county, one person at the time. And Eric is my special partner in California Space Center outside of California projects, and is also incredibly experienced entrepreneur leading a tech smart company. Rick Kellard, wonderful. Michael, thanks for having such a steady hand under the technical difficulty circumstances. You qualify to go in space, Michael.
Thank you. Yeah, I have Saudi here on the side too.
Saudi, yes. Yes, Saudi is, you know, I already acknowledged her as a, I think we have a Rick Keller joining us, a very special partner of mine in embracing space in a most vital way through media, Hollywood, and entertainment. So I don't know if Mike Turner, wow, great to see you guys. Dennis Nesky, Dennis Slim, fantastic. I am playing Ram and Man on the Moon because when we speak about space fund, space economy, space progress, one of the quests and commitments that Grant and I have made to you, to us, is that we will find the fastest way to put music in space. And one of the new ways to do it is, of course, through NFTs, but I will let Michael tell us when we are ready to formally start our great gathering.
Yeah.
And everybody who makes to this meeting, I have to take the names and put them on our list of NFTs release because they deserve it.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, that'd be pretty cool. Yeah. You have to tell us more about NFTs because I personally don't know too much about it.
Yes.
I guess we can go ahead and start now. Do you want to, I wanted to kind of start with your background a little bit. So, because you come from space heritage kind of in your family.
Yes, women come from Venus, men come from Mars. Mm-hmm. And I came from planet Earth, but indeed I was... Oh, I see, I recognize this handsome face. That's great to see you here. Thanks for joining us. Again, our rocket had some difficulties lifting off, but I think we have astronauts on board. So I will answer your question, and we have some very special people joining us, and let's make sure that Eric Armstrong is going to be invited as one of the first guests also. Mm-hmm. I am a third generation space maverick and space fighters, because everybody who is doing something in space, it takes a fight and perseverance. And my grandfather was someone that innovated something very important for all of us and for space, which is how to finance space and aerospace at the very, very early stage of emerging new economy. And my grandfather, Władysław Wilczyński, he was in charge of huge financial empire called railroads, but was visionary enough that in the 1925, 26, airlines started to emerge as a competitor or a collaborator of railroads, which were dominating the transportation, my grandfather was brave enough and visionary enough to help secure, negotiate and secure one of the first big loans from Lloyd's of London to finance one of the first airlines in Europe. So I feel very much that I'm living his heritage as I am innovating new ways to finance space economy. My father was a graduate of one of the prominent technology universities in Poland and became one of the first aerospace and space professors, engineers and champions, including he was pivotal in starting a space program, and it was called Cosmonauts program in Poland because we were under the Soviet dominance, and so you remember Soviets call astronauts cosmonauts. So he created a very cosmonaut program, which I hope to rebirth in Poland. I escaped from communistic Poland.
Wow.
As a graduate student, when it wasn't possible to travel freely. And I did something as difficult as landing on the moon because I won American scholarship to come and study in the United States. But because I had to find, and thank you, and I, to really arrive to this wonderful country, I smuggled myself, so to speak, on Venice Express, through Venice to Roma, Italy, and ask American ambassador for granting me a student visa to come to this country. And this space connection always stayed with me because when I graduated, I won a competition. There were about 2,000 people competing for the job, which was to become a first so-called account manager for Boeing, Boeing Aerospace and Boeing Commercial Services Company on behalf of Hewlett-Packard.
Wow.
That's
and,
cool.
You know, one would wonder how young immigrant from Poland could land a job like this. Mm-hmm. And this is, I have a very cool answer that was actually came from the guy who worked for David Packard. And he said, and this is what I think what it takes to be an astronaut. They said, you know what, we can teach you everything about technology, about space, about aerospace, but the key criteria we are looking for in hiring the best people to hire to manage Boeing for us is one key criteria, which is like 80% of all the criteria. And this criteria was courage. Courage. So this is what I'm sharing with you, with each of us, because everybody who is on this Zoom, I already know that you have above average courage in you. Courage is something that is really, you cannot learn it, you cannot teach it, you can invoke it, but this is a key criteria. So with my courage, I became later one of the early leaders in Silicon Valley. I was one of the key executives, one of the first startups who had valuation like $3 billion in today's dollars.
Wow.
And so on. So this is part of my heritage. Then I went back always. I always wanted to have my own rocket, and I always wanted to be the first to land on the moon. So I agreed to champion extremely powerful Houston company. So this was also my connection to NASA, Houston company that engaged me to be their astronauts to take over Europe was Compaq. So I pretty much, I ran a part of the European operations with a courageous task of launching Compaq between Poland and Moscow.
Mm-hmm.
It was in 1990s.
Mm.
So imagine me with the bodyguards and one of really first American entrepreneurs, executives after the Berlin Wall came down. So anyway, I will let you jump in maybe with some of the questions because don't want to make it a history lesson, but I came well equipped. And of course now my son, Grant Blaisdell, who was, you know, you were kind enough to host him, is carrying a first generation of our space commitment.
Yeah, so I think, Sadi, do you have some, Sadi prepared some questions for you.
Yeah, so
A nice comment from Maciej Szczygieł, who is staying up late in Poland. It's very late in Poland. About that he remembered those time. He is championing entrepreneurship in Poland and education. So that's very nice to have you, Maciej, on the call, on the Zoom.
Yeah, so we had some questions. I guess the first question would be, since you're such a space icon and such an inspiration for a lot of people, can you tell us what you have? You're welcome. Can you tell us what you have planned for 2021?
Ah, I love the question. I believe that 2021 is a pivotal year for us people of leadership and a quest to really accelerate our activities. Goal number one, and I have a couple of number ones, is to return for my Star Wars to relaunch California Space Center next to Vandenberg Air Force Base. What an incredible location. Mm-hmm. For those of you who might not know, Vandenberg Air Force Base is about 150 miles from Los Angeles. So it's not that far away. It's only 2 hours by car. Mm-hmm. This is where we actually launch rockets that go in space. And I've been probably at about 20 rocket launches at Vandenberg. This is, by the way, a picture from my Lompoc Vandenberg TV studio, because in addition to doing everything else, I launched a pro bono public TV channel about space exploration. The reason that I'm relaunching it is because a few years ago, I spent fortune, but it's not about money. I gave my life, my expertise, my Silicon Valley resources to create absolutely incredible business model and a concept for California Space Center, to build it next to Vandenberg Air Force Base, to synergize with incredible expertise resources. It's such a perfect place to build Space Valley, because Silicon Valley needs to be put, you know, not on the shelf, but we need to lead with the space. And I created a consortium of the big American corporations, because I was and am an entrepreneur, but I can bring and harness the power of huge corporations who followed me to this little town of Lompoc that they had no idea it exists. I said, this is the place, because you know what? City of Lompoc has kept for the last 40 years priceless land next to Vandenberg Air Force Base, 100 acres with panoramic view on the rocket launch site. City is dying economically. So I said, okay, let me leave my legacy. We will build California Space Center there. Little did I knew, and some of you can probably identify with it, and I know Eric does, local politics of small towns, small politicians with no vision, competence, short-term view, took the best out of me, and they illegally stopped the process of transferring land to my consortium. It was so painful, it was so unexpected, it was so stupid, and the corporations that joined me in my quest said, Eva, don't waste your time with this little town who doesn't know any better, let's go and find a new location. But guess what? I started to work with the local community. I started Lady Rocket Foundation. I got to know beautiful Hispanic, Black, young kids. And I said, no, I have to go back, because this city cannot be held hostage to incompetence and politics of a temporary politicians. Mm-hmm. And so I am launching a campaign to get this land back. I redone my vision of California Space Center to embrace everything that I always wanted to do: virtuality, streaming revenues, entertainment, innovation. But also, there is a Space Force, there is a new commitment to the space program. So I plan to also make it as a hub and invite Space Force, which I am also bringing to your attention, because they look for the relationship with us. Mm-hmm. They want to become more familiar. They want to integrate with the communities. They want to explain what guardians means, that they want to work with us. So I want to provide a place for Space Force to have their place as well. Then of course there is a Copernic space. Then which is an incredible economic operating system for space. It's a blockchain-based platform that will allow all of us to find a way to finance and participate in space economy. I am working on the proposal that follows up on my meeting with Elon Musk, Grant, and my meeting with Elon Musk, which is, you know, another story on its own. Of course, I'm launching Lady Rocket Media, expanding it, and working on attracting people like Netflix, Amazon, and others to follow me around, to film my events, fashion events, music events, because this is how I am breaking barriers between a lot of us who are not into technology, space technology, rockets, but should be attracted because there is so much to do in space. Mm-hmm. And space cities, I believe, is the future for the Earth, because we entrepreneurs, not governments, will curate enough money to build new generation of cities on planet Earth. So I'm looking at California Space Center as a test ground, proof of concept to do that. And of course, space fashion. And here is my Malibu t-shirt, Malibu Strong. I really wanted to share it with you here first. This is my startup that is utilizing, that is working with Copernic, that is utilizing data from the satellites to help us here on Earth anticipate fires before they happen.
Wow.
And this is based on my personal experience of surviving the 2018 fire, which consumed part of the Malibu. And this t-shirt is actually Malibu Strong, was given to community leaders after the fire in 2019, where we came together as a community to find out what it is we can do to protect ourselves from fire. If it's going to work in Malibu, we'll take it globally. So, you know, I believe you have to have like 15 projects because you never know which rocket is going to take off.
Yeah, right? That's good.
You're absolutely right. So it's unfortunate that that happened to you in the past with the California Space Center.
Yes.
What do you have to say in regards to the future, some advice regarding space funding for our economy? What do you have to say about that?
And excellent funding. I believe that we are technology rich, but cash poor. As a space entrepreneur, I've experienced a limitation of existing sources of funding. Let it be angel investors, let it be venture capital, let it be equity funds, let it be hedge funds, because there is a lack of frequently knowledge and understanding that space enterprises cannot be put into the same bucket like another Uber or another Facebook or another Airbnb. We are significantly bigger risk takers. We are championing fields that are emerging. If we succeed, the rewards will be spectacular because of the size of space economy. As a result of it, we attract a very unusual breed of investor who is looking for what I am looking for. And there is, you know, financial upside, but it is not the key criteria to take a risk. Mm-hmm. The key criteria to appreciate and fight for a privileged position to take chance on building something like Copernic Space or California Space Center or next generation engine, because if it happens, it changes the destiny on Earth and in space. Mm-hmm. This is why I launched Copernic Space. It was actually after my experience with California Space Center, and because I wanted to accelerate my ability to gather up in a new way investors using what we already know now. But when I was doing it in 2016, it was really a leading edge. It was just emerging. to use blockchain, its transparency, its scalability, its ability to issue cryptocurrency or tokens or non-fungible tokens as an innovative way to finance unpredictable but spectacular new space projects. I had to wait a few years because at that time, blockchain as a technology wasn't robust enough to support what I call enterprise quality companies. It was good for, you know, Kickstarter type of the ideas or good for the, you know, blockchain management. But to run financial enterprise, it is only about 2 years ago when we can do it. And this is when Grant joined me and took over the leadership of Copernic, and we are very, very close to launching three type of currencies to finance thousands of startups and projects, including NASA intellectual property, which is sitting dormant on shelf because there is no process to monetize it. I also promised to introduce and talk about a new fund for space, which will scale up and go beyond what we currently have operating the space capacity, because I am not only fund, I already have my own space startup, but I will be working with Copernic Space, which is only the onboarding spectacular space companies with ability to digitize space assets, which means here is the fund which can work with the inventory of space companies that already exist and will be expanding dramatically. So I am obsoleting process which kills us in the space economy, where you go and pitch yourself to the VC, go through the, you know, 10 weeks process, get yes or no. Valuation is never what anyone expects. We cannot finance American space company old-fashioned VC way, because we will never get where we should go. This is why Copernic Space, my fund, collaboration together, onboarding of IP projects and everything from startup all the way to the unused inventory of Boeing Lockheed with SpaceX in between. So we have a system, scalable system, transparent system to make the process quick. But we need concentration of mega funds that will synergize with Copernic Space. I call it sometimes hedge fund, but it's not really a hedge fund. I am just dropping this name sometime because it's going to tolerate significantly higher risk element, will work with the shorter periods of investment time, because traditional VCs milk you for the 10 years ROI. We cannot wait 10 years in space. We'll be selecting those projects which can return a return on investment or a legacy or potentiality within 2 to 5 years, because space needs $1 trillion to take off. And the last thing, it's going to be optimized around creating infrastructure and supportive resources to get us to Mars. Because Elon Musk needs additional people, additional risk takers, additional visionaries, because rocket is just a transportation. What goes inside of the rocket needs to get funded. Infrastructure on Earth needs to get funded. So this is how I am positioning also our new space fund.
Yeah, yeah. I think people need to start, like you're saying, coming to terms with space being like an option for them. Because, you know, the new rocket, what's it called?
Falcon 9?
Not Falcon 9. The new ones. What is it again? Starlink, right?
Starlink is the satellite.
Satellites.
His new rocket.
Starship.
There you go. Okay, sorry, I was blanking. But yeah, so with Starship, you know, it's going to start happening. It's going to happen pretty quickly. So yeah, I think.
Yes.
What? Yeah.
So I am creating a vision system infrastructure to provide a destination place for those who can afford to put big bucks, but Copernic Space is democratizing space. So I will be bringing big bucks, but Copernic Space will allow you to co-own part of the Starship, or better yet, what goes inside of the Starship, which is where the money will be made.
So you said you have a lot of plans, and we'll try to touch up on all of them. So you said that Elon Musk is kind of setting the ground for the future of space. We kind of know what his vision is, but what is your vision for the space industry?
My vision starts with you, two of you, other people on this call, and all of us. Unlike Elon, whose focus is on the technology, and I love technology, I am a technologist, but I take my energy and power to find a way to harness the technology to reinvent life on Earth, prosperity, access to capital, access to being a part of the space economy, and democratizing it. My theme is also, let's be better on Earth before we go to Mars. Let's be better on Earth before we go to Mars, because I am looking at space as the biggest new economy, which is really starting here on Earth.
Yeah, the way that I always articulate it is, when you start to move out into space, you're actually beginning the steps of multiplying the entire globe's economy.
Perfect. I couldn't say it better, Michael. But very few people look at space this way. When I talk about space economy, they think about mining on the moon or Mars. And yes, that's part of it. But before we go to Mars, there will be $1 trillion that is going to, or preferably Copernicus or Lady Rocket NFTs or some other currency that is going to circulate here on Earth. We will create a parallel financial and economic system, because the one that exists is obsoleted even for the existing companies on Earth. We cannot depend on the political moods of the governments, elections, Wall Street ups and downs as a way to secure predictability of financing for space. We cannot leave astronauts without budget, which really is driven not by the Congress and politicians, but by us. And this is why I'm so excited about Copernic Space, because it has been designed with love, care, protection of the democratization process, and something that I have been doing for several years, which I should speak about more. Going to the communities, going to the communities with message that space is also for you, that you can become an interior decorator of Lady Rocket. You can become artist who is going to carry the message of goodness of space here on Earth. You can become fashion designer, doctor, biomedicine researcher, makeup artist. Space is going to drive so much more than the rocket. Actually, I believe that rocket, although right now so significant, is not going to be a critical item to get us to Mars. Critical item that you also put on your agenda for today is spacesuits. Mm-hmm. And if you ask me, I would agree with a special company that is designing, it's the only one company in the United States designing spacesuit that is already working on spacesuit for Mars. Elon will be ready with his rocket, but spacesuits might not be ready. Because we need to return to Earth a pieces of material that were just deposited on Mars for testing, to see if fabric and technology we are going to use will be sufficient to protect humans. So the news here is, yes, I am working very hard with experts to take this type of space technology, space design consideration, but also transform it into wearable street fashion. Like the jacket I am wearing, it has a great Lady Rocket picture from Santa Susana Mountains where NASA tested its Apollo. But I'm already working on the collection with some young designers that will stage in usage of certain fabrics, modules, certain design, and also Internet of Things, so we can become kind of connected community of space here on Earth.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea, because you see, like, you saw the trend of like hip hop and streetwear become such a force in fashion. And
yes,
once space becomes more mainstream, that, you know, that makes a lot of sense, I think.
Great statement. Making space more mainstream. And you know how I do it? Where is my biggest? I am not focused on convincing or working inside of the space industry. You know, we are sold on it. I take my dollars, I take my personality strengths, I go outside of the space industry. This is whom we have to attract. Mm-hmm. And there's a differentiation about my sources of funding, not from space companies, not from space investors, from consumer companies, from ultra luxury companies, from the company that is sponsoring my hair, L'Oreal. Owner of L'Oreal has $50 billion in personal wealth. Very nice French family. They are looking for more meaningful usage of their technology. And there is now tremendous excitement about what I am doing with the hair color. It's a statement. Louis Vuitton, a consumer company, luxury goods, valuation higher than Volkswagen. You see, the wealth is shifting from technology companies, manufacturing companies, to emotion-driven companies. So this is the audience I am bringing over to our area.
Yeah, that would be really exciting to see all those products. I know, like, I agree with you. That would reach such a different sort of demographic.
Yes.
Bring in more money.
More demographic, Black community. And this is why it was so important to me to have Eric here with me, that I would like you to invite shortly, because my passion, being from the country that used to be one of the most powerful countries in Europe, Poland, who had to live under the dominance of Soviets for way too long, I understand how you have to emotionally get yourself out and become free. And this is why I identify with a lot of minorities here, including, you know, incredible people who are recognized for hip hop, basketball, but not necessarily included in our Silicon Valley quest, technology quest, to bring them and let us share with them their talents, our talents together. And this is why I was so excited to meet Eric Armstrong from Mississippi, who is a great example of someone that I want to have as a part of, you know, my racket. So I know that Eric is prepared to speak briefly. So if it's okay with you, if we could invite Eric to speak. Eric Armstrong.
Yeah. Hey, how are you?
Good. Good evening. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah. Hey, thank you guys for having me. And lady, you are the bomb. We are just loving everything that you stand for. And every time you talk, I hear a little bit more about how your vision and my vision, it's intertwined. So, and you know, guys, y'all might not know, but we met on Clubhouse. And as soon as I heard her, she just gave us a brief synopsis of what she was about and what she was trying to, you know, her vision. And I was like, wow, I have to meet this lady. And next thing you know, we connected, and it was kind of like destiny almost. I mean, we connected in a way that was just amazing. And like she said, she has a passion for helping minorities and helping boost this space. And with the blockchain and with the NFT technology that's going on right now, it is going to put all the power back into the people's hands, you know. And like you said, with democratizing, with the NFTs, with the tokens, you'll be able to level that playing field again. But there's not a lot of people who knows about this. We're so new in this space, even though NFT's been around for a while, but right now it's new, and people are learning about it. And I'm in a lot of different new projects that's dealing with NFTs. And then this one right here with Lady Rocket, I'm just ecstatic. and just give you a little bit about myself. I am from Grenada, Mississippi. And as you know, Mississippi, we're kind of seem like we're last on a lot of fronts. And my vision is to, you know, it's mostly about innovation, you know, innovation and pretty much putting Mississippi on the map, helping, you know, helping people who are less fortunate, who, like she says, you know, not participating in this space, don't even have the idea that they can participate in the technology field. I've always, I've never been to Silicon Valley, want to go. And I have a computer store called TechSmart, as you see the logo behind me, been open for 8 years. And my dream is say, hey, if I can't go to Silicon Valley, can I create a Silicon Valley here in Grenada? Can I open up a, what do you call it? A warehouse where we build computers, or where we build computer chips, where we build the motherboards, the everything, you know? And then here come lady, she's want to, you know, do a rocket center, you know? So it's awesome.
And you know, being a space entrepreneur also means connecting the dots very quickly, but also being deeply knowledgeable about the resources out there. And after I met Eric, with his company, with his expertise, with his feet on the ground, he's a perfect candidate and partners to join my space satellite endeavors. And speaking of Mississippi, which has incredible heritage, but is economically, unfortunately, between 46 to 50 on the very key criteria like health, like average income. But we can change it, and we can change it quickly. If Mississippi were to be selected, and this is what I want to recommend by, among others, I'm using name of Elon Musk because it makes a point faster. He's launching his Starlink satellites that are supposed to deliver faster, initially free internet to some of the areas. I want to team up with Eric and give people like Musk and others an opportunity to contribute the resources to launch space internet, not in a ritzy locations, not right. necessarily in the middle of, you know, Beverly Hills, but in Mississippi. Mm-hmm. Economy can get its boost in an incredible way. So this is one of the action items that Eric and I committed ourselves to.
That's right. That's right. And that was one of my visions. I was trying to figure out, okay, you know, with this pandemic that hit, and then these kids in these rural areas, they could not get internet. So they were suffering, you know, and the schools and everybody was just suffering. They were like, hey, we're in these rural areas. We can't get good quality internet. We can't turn in homework assignments on time. People needed to work from home. Guess what? They couldn't work from home properly because they were in these rural areas, couldn't get good quality internet. And I was thinking of an ideal of using 5G technology, a mix between 5G and 4G technology, me and one of my business partners, Doug Rowden. And basically, we were going to do that. But guess what? When I seen what Elon Musk is doing, I said, that's the answer. You know, I don't have to fight with AT&T or these big guys to let me in to have the backhaul. We could just go directly to the satellite and, you know, have high speed internet, you know, in these rural areas. So I saw that as an answer.
Yeah, I think people that have internet, you know, that grew up with internet, you don't really think of people not having access to internet. You kind of take it for granted, like water or something. But, right. You know, even with water, some people don't have good water. So internet access, not everyone has it. And that's a good point. I think that's great. You guys are working on that. And I think Starlink is an awesome solution to that, because all you need is a phone and, you know, you just plug it in and you have like high quality internet right out of the box.
Exactly. But you see, it's not technology that is challenged, because Elon has had this technology forever. It is to find grassroots champions who find the team on the ground, social mission, economic mission, and the way to make it happen in a meaningful way. So I was really inspired to put together with Eric Mississippi on the map, because it is so obvious that it should be one of the first, not the first areas to deploy existing technology. So speaking of space economy, the biggest black hole exists not with the rocket inside of the rocket. Biggest black hole exists where actually I am spending the biggest part of my passion, courage, endeavoring, which is capturing an opportunity, defining it in a human, humanitarian, and economic sense, and then showcase it how space economy solves problem on Earth. So Bernie Sanders is not confused anymore when he's criticizing the space race, because no one educated him that is most likely space economy that is going to improve equality in states like Mississippi and others. So I am spending so much effort on just, you know, promoting different view of space. And I just want to acknowledge Inara Tabir, if she's still with us. Is she with us?
Yeah, she's here.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Inara, I love what you said. She's so totally right, indicating that when we will film a story about what Eric, you and I are talking about, bringing space to Mississippi, can you imagine what a documentary it would be? It would kick ass. It's not going to be another Kardashian sell me some lipstick stuff. It's going to let's go and change the world. Because what she's saying, Inara is saying, and if we can put her in as one of the speakers, that bringing Hollywood as a part of the ingredient is a spectacular way to fundraise and carry the message. And Inara, this is why I have Lady Rocket Media. It's actually an operational venture that is right now pursuing exactly this path. And in the context of semi-reality show, a couple of documentaries, but you are totally right. And I am so happy that you joined us, because
we'd
love to follow up with you later.
Definitely. Well, you know, I've been working for 12 years on that specific goal of getting that capture with the public. If we can inform and impassion the public to understand that space is the solution to the problems on Earth, then we would have the funding and the political clout we need to make it, to make space open for everybody. So I always say that, you know, scarcity ends where space begins. If we can make people understand that, the problem solves itself.
Beautiful. I'm so thrilled that we have such an inspired discussion. So it's not only technology, space, rockets, all this stuff. You know what you guys are doing here? While we are being hosted by our wonderful couple, we are having passionate, powerful discussion. And Inara, we have power. Politicians are going to knock on our door. We have an empowerment to self-appoint, because you know what? I know politicians, I spend the time with them. I am very successful with the politician on the high level. I'm less successful with little politicians who are sometimes better in the backstabbing. But you know what? We cannot wait for them. And we have to use blockchain and the creation of new law and a new financial system to run with the show and tell them what to do. Because guess what? They work for us. We are just not executing our power enough. Mm-hmm. They work for us. And here's a good timing for Inara also to take your message and our message. NASA is appointing a new administrator. He has not been confirmed. He is 79-year-old white guy from Florida who is not particularly recognized for his support of space entrepreneurship. Okay. And was not particularly supportive as a senator to provide funding through NASA to companies like SpaceX to get us going. I have to wonder what's the strategy behind appointing him. And I wish him well as a person, but I would much rather see someone else being in charge of NASA now when Artemis project is in danger, when NASA commercialization programs are endangered. So Inara, please connect with me afterwards. Tell us a little bit about yourself. How did you choose to be such an astronaut here?
Here, 1 second, let me unmute her. There you go, okay.
Well, you know, I grew up in foster care and in the streets basically, and I had nothing. And I thought, you know, I'll never get anywhere. I'll never be able to be in sciences. I can't get an education. And at some point I just kicked myself and went, you know what? I'm going to find a way around this. So I started off in social media and I realized I had a good niche there. So now my network is 250,000 members of aerospace enthusiasts that are in the public. And I found a way to be in this world and exist there. I partner with all kinds of space organizations and just make value wherever I can. And I try to make people understand that no matter who you are, no matter what your background or your skills, there's a place for you in space. There's something you can contribute to this, and that it's not the domain of old rich white guys who have, you know, great degrees and specialty skills. It's for everybody.
Wow. Thank you for joining me. And this is what you have accomplished. Congratulations, because I know how difficult it is to get so much attention. And I would love to work with you because, again, the reason that I started to have my hair blue is because when I went to Compton in Los Angeles, some other areas, I had to break with the message through something that, you know, it's cool and friendly and young Black girls pick up. And, you know, I brought my Lady Racket shows not to NASA, not to SpaceX. I brought it to Beverly Mall, where you have a lot of minorities coming and looking at, you know, Gucci and Louis Vuitton. And I was there with my offices saying, yeah, come on over, let's talk about fashion and space. And those little girls and their mothers recognized that, you know what, I can find perhaps my place in space. And I now I feel like I am connected. I feel like someone is thinking about me. Yeah. Because, you know, a lot of people in space don't operate at this level that you do, Inara. And, you know, what I'm doing. And Lompoc is my place where I spend the time with Boys and Girls Club. I launched a global educational platform also for Lompoc kids to interact with kids in Europe around Mars and all this stuff. So, you know, do whatever it takes.
Absolutely. You know, I think it would be neat to see something like a Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts organization, but geared towards space sciences. Instead yes. of tying knots and going camping, they could be building modules or going to space camps or space museums, yes. learning about space travel. I mean, we could build that nationally for everyone.
Yeah, I already have a miniature of this program in Lompoc and in little country, Lithuania. And we have a very special guest here. If Igor is still with us, I hope he is. He is a Mars champion and media.
Yeah, hi, I'm here.
Hi, great, Igor. So thank you for staying up so late, but Igor is another example of incredible self. Michael and our great hosts, if at some moment you could let Igor speak, he's putting together Lady Racket program in Croatia, in Zagreb. And he yeah. already leads his Mars program there. So thanks for being with us, Igor.
No problem. It's my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Tell us about your Mars program. By the way, what we are doing is we are orchestrating meeting with American Embassy in Croatia. I want to work with those smaller countries that are not included in our big, you know, programs of space because they have talented youth and talented people. And we Americans need to reach out to them as well. So okay. Igor is yeah. working on the meeting with American Ambassador for us because American embassies help me finance a Lady Racket program internationally.
Well, yeah, and they want to support that, which is really good news. It only took one email for them to, you know, say that they're on board with this. And now we go to stage two, and that is, you know, to make a better introduction to them and to get them more formal so we can approach schools there. And so we can, you know, say that, you know, hey, the American Embassy is also supporting us in this. We have the Lady Racket Foundation also supporting us in that. So, yeah, We also have a school that is, it will be like a pilot project. It is a school to which my kid goes, and it's a very great school because they do a lot of science stuff. They do a lot of education stuff. Of course, it's a school, but they're very open to everything. And they have a great principal who is also open to new stuff. And a great teacher, my kid has a great teacher. She's already on board with this. Unfortunately, she's sick at this time. So we're going to have to wait for some, you know, some time to pass, but you know, slowly but surely we'll get there, and that is great.
Or maybe even fast and surely.
Just a little setback from COVID because she's kind of sick with that, right. So but
the key is and you know what, I even didn't have a time or didn't care to have a website done, but I have a cool Instagram about Lady Rocket Foundation. It's optimized not around STEM, not around technology, but around space entrepreneurship. How to be an astronaut, which is value system, energy, passion, courage, how to build new society and space art, music, and entertainment. Now I'm passing over to our gracious hosts because they ask great questions and have great comments. So I am going to listen.
Yeah, so something that keeps coming up on my mind, me and Sadia, we just watched, I don't know if you guys have seen it, it's a documentary on Netflix called Seaspiracy. If anyone's seen it, just do a thumbs up on the reactions. And if you haven't seen it, if you have Netflix or if you have a friend that has Netflix, this is like required.
What is it, Michael?
It's called Seaspiracy. Let me spell it in the chat.
Okay.
It's a documentary on Netflix. I think it just came out yesterday.
Yeah.
Just came out yesterday. So.
Okay. Yes, I see it.
Yeah, and the reason I bring this up is because in 2015, we had a pitch contest with Space Angels and the Heisenberg Trust, and we had a $5,000 prize, and it went to Ursa Space. So they are in upstate New York, and they do satellite imagery. And one of the things that they actually promote is monitoring illegal fishing. And that's a really good application and really timely right now because of this documentary that's out to show how space technology has a direct impact on all of our lives, because the sea is like very important to the health of the Earth. Yes. And it's, if you look at the charts, everything's like not looking so good. And then you have space fighting back with, you know, satellite imagery, catching these illegal fishers, and it's a great example
of course. Yeah. Thank you for bringing my attention, everybody's attention. That's perfect, and this is exactly what Copernic Space is optimized around. By the way, the mission of Copernic Space is not only to democratize space, meaning give you a partial ownership of those satellites, of this data, for sometimes symbolic financial contribution, but also our mission is to protect Earth. And on the top of my list is also political refugees who can be aided, especially political refugees and climate change refugees, because especially in Africa, you have millions of people disfranchised because of the climate change and because of the political. So, but this is why we are building both a fund and a Copernic Space and NFTs, so we can show generosity of heart and not only deal with Bitcoin-like financial speculators.
Yeah. Yeah, whenever you do anything Bitcoin-like, those guys jump in there and they start, you know, marketing their whatever it is. Yes. They're doing.
Yes.
But speaking of NFTs, me and Sadi, we don't know too much about it. We just know that like you buy the NFT, and then you kind of have ownership of it. But right now it's completely taking off. Do you want to talk more about?
Yes. Yes. And Eric also mentioned it. And this is also how we met. NFT, if you choose to do it this way, allows you to recognize physical asset like painting or like, you know, probably not this because it's owned by Disney, but some kind of a physical creation. And depending on your intentions, you have opportunity to capture it in the form of the digital image and present it on the open market as a digital asset standing for subjective value, because ultimate value, what's so unique about NFTs is that the value is in the eye of the beholder. Mm-hmm. It's not in the value of stock market or ROI or what Goldman Sachs thinks about it. It's wonderful because it obsoletes all those financial criteria and gives you an opportunity to buy digital image, either based on the principle that you happen to love the person who is doing it, love the art that is being, or love the cause that stands behind NFT that you might be very passionate, excited about. And in my case, I decided to combine three of those: authentic, incredible art, and you could see some of it on the invitation that was shared by our host, which is authentic art that I secured from the authentic artist that represent my authentic commitment to space, earth, ecology, which is so beautifully represented by astronauts, the bird, the planet Earth, and issue it as a Lady Rocket Space for Earth token, which captures a value of the art, but also a mission, because I am not going to run away with money like a lot of, you know, other people, and God bless them, and spend it on my home or the Ferrari, or in my case, McLaren. Ecologic McLaren, they just announced it a month ago, the ecological McLaren. I am going to reinvest it with causes that I am committed to, like with Eric in Mississippi, like in buying time on satellites, but through Copernic Space, so we can capture the data that will talk about sea pirates. So this is a creation of wealth that space can inspire. So NFTs are, you know, Grimes, for example, you probably recognize Grimes because of her artistic capabilities, but also she's Elon Musk's wife. Mm-hmm. And she issued a couple of tokens and attracted $7 million, which is not bad. You probably heard about the artist who attracted $64 million for his digital art. And there are those who cannot attract much. A lot means, of course, it relies on the publicity cause, you know, innovation. So I pre-introduced my token at the Los Angeles County Museum of Art. Mm. See, because as a lead director, I like to combine, you know, unexpected location. No one from space goes and hangs around, you know, the Museum of Contemporary Art. I do. So I said, okay, why don't I plant myself there and talk about art, promote the museum, promote art, and we'll be repeating it this Sunday. So it pretty much gives you unprecedented way to create opportunity for not only wealth, but for the cause, and doing it in a very, very unique way. I think that, for example, if Eric and I team up around NFT, who knows? We might create a new category like civic pro publico bono NFT. I think Mississippi NFT would be so cool. What do you think, Eric?
Let me unmute him 1 second. There we go.
All right, I'm here. Look, I totally agree with you, Lady Rocket. Mississippi NFT would be the first of its kind, first of all. And I'm loving how I'm in these spaces where a first of its kind. And I think that would do the whole state, you know, justice, as well as the people who, like you said, those underserved, underprivileged. Guess what? If you can get your hands on this NFT, and if this can bring value to you, or to your project, or to your business, you know, or whatever. You know,
let's do it. It's not that difficult. Let's do it. Right. Here is my another NFT, and I showed it, I think, to Eric when he was with his daughter.
Yeah, that she's gonna wear that.
My racket designed wearable art.
I love it.
It's a jacket actually created for my granddaughter Ulysses and Elon Musk's son X. It says everything that I want to leave all of us with. It says, let's be better on Earth before we go to Mars. This is a racket jacket from Mars collection of Lady Racket. Because of Grimes, I have here Paderewski and Chopin, two wonderful Polish composers. And of course, Lady Racket Foundation as a sponsor of it. It was designed by a young artist from Poland, Mariko. So this is going to be also Mississippi and then Space Jacket. And money goes for the causes, not for another private jet or something that I used to value, but I don't anymore. Expensive house in Malibu. This is going to go deck to us.
Very good. Yeah, that's
right. That's awesome.
Thank you. There is a wonderful doctor. I you know your audience. I will let you choose some other people.
Dr. Ken, did you want to say anything? I think Eva might have been giving a shout out to you just there. Kind of put you on the spot a little bit. But I think, do you have any more questions? All right, yeah, Saudi has some more questions for you.
Yes. You're such an inspirational person. Why don't you tell us what inspires you? What's your favorite movie? What's your favorite book? And your favorite music?
Well, thank you for this important to me question. You know, I come from the family who has centuries of tradition of doing good things for other people. And there is a French saying, noblige oblige, which means nobility obligates. And it used to mean when, you know, Europe was full of aristocrat nobility, this was one of the golden rules. Well, it's not the case anymore, but it was passed through generation from my mother, whom I have to acknowledge as really a source of inspiration, who under the communistic regime was brave enough to wear black leather pants and animal print pants, not as a fashion statement, but as a political statement. Because you being from Bangladesh, you know that depending on the political system, what you wear, how you look, is sometimes act of courage. And my mother was, I've seen. So when I came to this country, after, you know, being really challenged in how I got here, I brought with me the legacy of my mother, who was a technologist. She was a technical writer. She was translator, of course, my father, to do something important. I didn't come here just to live comfortably. I wanted to live uncomfortably, but with the meaning. And believe me, last few years were probably the most uncomfortable time in my life because I abdicated a lot of privileges that come with self-focus. It comes from being an executive of prominent companies to being someone that is putting everything on the line that I believe in. So I want to live a life that hopefully leaves something behind, enriches lives of others, and also moves humanity and protects Earth. I have now a little granddaughter called Ulysses. Ulysses Grant is 7 months old, and she's great-great-granddaughter of President Grant. It's on my son's side, you know, his ancestors were. So, and Ulysses was born in Warsaw, Poland, but it's an American. So I want, you know, all of us to be together, engaged. I see that our wonderful doctor came back, so I will conclude my, so he can speak too. And I love your question about book and film. And I haven't thought about it for quite some time, but spontaneously what came to my mind when you asked me about film is a film that young generation might not recognize anymore, but called Someone Likes It Hot, with Marilyn Monroe and Jack Lemmon. It's a great comedy ahead of its time. Another film is called Sex Mission, but it's not about sex. It's not about mission. It's about more about eviction of men from space by women. And it is about two astronauts, Polish astronauts, who are going in space, and they are two guys, and they are returning to Earth. And say, my God, Earth is run by women. And there's no guys left. So here they found themselves two guys surrounded by, but the bottom line is a queen woman in charge of planet Earth, in a moment of weakness, discloses that she happens to be a man disguised as a woman. But it's a comedy. And of course, Anna Karenina, and of course, you know, some of the E.T. is my, you know, beloved film. Books, there are many, but War and Peace, it's incredible book. Atlas Shrugged by Anne Rand. Atlas Shrugged, I read when I was 12 years old, and it is inspired me to come to the States and maybe not build exactly what she's talking about, but I'm all for independence, liberty, and creation of the parallel universe. And my favorite fashion designer is Valentino, Tom Ford, because Tom Ford created the first designer shoe using apple leather to obsolete animal leather in a high fashion.
Oh,
that's great.
We have Dr. Ken back, I think, and he looks great.
I'm already in space.
You are looking so cool.
That is such an... Thank you. That is such an awesome outfit that you have. Is that Valentino or
no? It's a lady rocket. Actually, it was designed for me. And now that you are asking, I will see if I can turn my back with a lady rocket on the back.
Wow.
And it says by California Space Center here. But thank you.
Okay. Well, I'm working on something that I hope is going to fall in line with all the things that you're doing. Just like Eric said, it seems like all these different ideas that you have are things that I've been also chewing on for several years now. And I really believe that it's space cities that's the future of humanity, not necessarily going straight to Mars or Europa or the moon and habitating those places, but in fact, building our own near perfect self-sustainable worlds in space.
Yes.
And so I had, I actually had started writing a science fiction book, and the nemesis in it actually turned out to be so much like the last president that I was like, no, I'm not going to even write that book. Mm-hmm. But in it was a guy that became the world's first trillionaire, and he developed a means of being able to get into outer space, where you could get more cheaper. And so that was really where I came up with this idea of the space railway. And so I decided, well, maybe I should probably patent the idea before I write the book, and change the nemesis to some other person. And in any case, I've been doing a lot of work over the last 6 months, since September, getting ready for a National Science Foundation grant. They requested a full project proposal from me for a phase one grant. Mm-hmm. So they liked my initial idea. Now, having worked on it in great detail, I've came to find out that there's a lot of real good innovation that can just really make this possible. and that less is more. Less is absolutely more when you're talking about space access. If you're going the route of a say the elevator is another concept that's been around for 20 years. I had no idea that it was out there, but they have on the drawing boards really bulky equipment that they say that themselves it's going to take like 30 years to build, which is kind of from an investor's perspective a little bit scary. My concept, ultra lightweight from inside to out. And I'm sure with the right kind of funding, we can get this thing done in 5 to 10 years, where we're talking about 24/7 access of a capacity to build the kinds of cities that you see in science fiction. So
very interesting. This is
April the 6th.
Why Copenric Space has been formed to provide a place also for the concept idea, which cannot be taken away, because even patents don't protect. But if you use smart contracts and you put your idea on Copenric Space, we promote it, people will have an opportunity to choose to support you and provide through NFTs. There will be three types of tokens. One will be connected to IP type of the assets. Another one will be NFT. And then another one, the last one, because it's the most troublesome and forces you to comply with the old-fashioned financial system, security commissions, etc. But you see, the beauty of blockchain is that you can protect your IP in the best possible way while allowing people to potentially finance you. Without selling equity, without giving up ownership of your IP, without dealing with the old-fashioned way of monetizing IP, which is licenses, and with focusing on gathering funding to commercialize idea, which normally on the current system takes years. With Copenric Space, we hope it will take very quickly.
Yeah, Eric, that sounds really interesting.
That's Dr. Ken.
Oh, sorry, I'm getting mixed up. Let me unmute you real quick again. So if we unmute you, you kind of get stuck. Yes. So just raise your hand and we'll unmute you. But yeah, space elevator is a really exciting idea. I know sometimes I go to sleep at night and I can't stop thinking about, you know, how you could do that, and I've come up with different ways, but I'm really excited to see that you've gotten as far as you have. And just to go off of what Lady Rocket's saying, and let me unmute Eric too. You guys have seen what's going on in the news with GameStop, and that just shows you the power of the retail investor. Mm-hmm. And it's only gonna grow. You know, Bitcoin's distributing the wealth, and then the retail investors are getting more savvy. And you know, you have platforms like Copernic Space coming online. So funding, you know, bigger projects like this in a distributed way is actually becoming more of a reality every day. Me and Sadia, we invested in a company called Soulstar through a platform called WeFunder. Mm-hmm. So they don't do the tokens like Copernic's gonna do, but they do normal like equity distribution. Mm-hmm. And normally before, this is a new law that came out just like 4 or 5 years ago, and it allows you to not have to be an accredited investor to basically, you know, put $100 down and get equity on a brand new company. So yeah, Dr. Kent, I would check out Copernic and connect with them, because you know, raising that money might actually be possible today through a platform like this.
Yeah. And I would like to follow
them on LinkedIn.
Very good. Thanks, yeah. Michael and Sadia, bringing it up. And let me just add what excites me most about Copernic, and it's grounded in my incredible belief in the strength of average Americans and other people, but we Americans have proved it in the past on the great scale, that it is not only investment opportunity that attracts us. We put our money behind a mission that I chose to call Marshot. I promise you to talk about Marshot, because we already know a moonshot. When President Kennedy was talking, this is a moonshot, but we are going to make it. So let me tell you about how American people reacted to it. And this is now why Copernic Space has a process for it. When I met with NASA retired marketing people who worked on Apollo 11 mission, and I asked them, what was your biggest challenge? They said that the biggest challenge were millions of envelopes sent to NASA headquarters with $5, $10, $20, $100 in those envelopes, from Americans who are saying, this is my contribution so we can go to moon. And this is this American generosity. And this is why Moonshot made me think about Marshot. And this is why my fund, our fund, is also going to give an opportunity for Americans to contribute to something that we strongly believe in, relevant to getting us on Mars, but also relevant to the project like yours, Ken, which, you know, doesn't have to have just profit-thirsty investors, but also those who, just like Michael said, this is a really cool idea, let's do it. Here's my $100. And Copernic will issue a token in return for it, so it's better than envelopes which went to NASA 50 years ago.
That is awesome. And Dr. Ken, you know, great minds think alike. I'm talking about like probably 2 weeks ago, I was thinking about how can we, just like the tower in the Bible, the Tower of Babylon, I said, what if we could build something that would go straight up into space, you know? And here you go talking about this railway. I don't know if it looks like that. I don't know what it looks like. Can you describe, you know, kind of what you're talking about?
Yes, I actually have several illustrations on my website at spacerailway.com.
Spacerailway.com.
And it starts off as a multi-railed track that is made of carbon nanotubes, which are an ultralight fiber, but it's also the hardest substance known to man. So using a what I call a stringer device, we can actually thicken this multi-track into a single monorail so that it's able to withstand impacts from all of the space junk that's obviously going to be hitting it at 17,000 miles an hour, and still be able to, deliver these goods and people to these destinations that we're going to be building collectively. Because I've seen a lot of different companies that are ready to start building in space, but the rate limiting factor is rocket engines. And I kind of like to think of rocket engines as how back in the old West, you had the stagecoach or you had the covered wagons. Well, but then when they built the transcontinental train in the 1860s, it just totally revolutionized the ability for people to get out west and strike a fortune. And that's how I see the space railway.
This is amazing. I mean, you just took what was in my brain and just, I mean, it's right here. I mean, except for it's not exactly what I was thinking about, but this is it. This is amazing.
Yeah, it's the cosmic mind. It's out there in the universe.
I have a request also from James Watkins to speak. So when we are done, if Michael, we could. But I didn't want to interrupt, just wanted to get him in before he might leave.
Yeah, yeah, I just unmuted him now. So James, if you wanna speak now, you're able to.
Thank you, Dr. Ken.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Ken. I'm gonna check that's awesome. And good luck on the Science Foundation grant.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah, we'll follow your progress. We'll tweet out we'll share your story and support you as any way we can, because space elevator, that'd be so cool. All right, I think, yeah, James, you are unmuted now. If you want to go ahead and say hi.
Okay, I'll call him back. Hello, am I being heard?
Yes.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, all right. I want to thank you for the opportunity to be unmuted. I was just ready to write you an email where I was in the process. I don't have a lot of time this evening, but I've been working on a project since the early 1980s, and it is directly related to space exploration. And without divulging too much, I would like to find out more about whom I could speak to, but I have copyrights and what have you on it. And I know that in a way it kind of connects everything we spoke about or that I've heard tonight, because of the modality that it works. It's all encompassing and has the potential of really helping tremendously commercially, and particularly with STEM activities. And so in regards to being well known in this community, I'm not, and I would like to connect with somebody who would direct me so that I can miss the minefields of talking to the wrong people or giving out information that would be sensitive. But I come from a family that was entrepreneurial. My father borrowed $60 back in the 1940s and had five children and lived in a row home in Baltimore, Maryland. And the credit manager said, "You've got to be crazy. You have no equity. You have nothing." But my father said, "I can make this work." And what he did in a nutshell was he started this business called Topcraft, which became the largest business of its kind in the country. And they ultimately produced the Formica kitchens, vanitories, and bathrooms for all the Sears and Montgomery Wards. And so with that as my model, which was large shoes to fill, I have gotten into my own venue, and I've gotten some success there. I will say that I spoke with Isaac Asimov, and I have some other significant kinds of things, but I have to be careful because my lawyer that is in the realm of intellectual property says to be careful, and that's why I use the term landmines and what have you. But in fact, I need to talk to the right person, and I think they'll be very, very happy that they spoke to me. So without taking any more time, I come from an entrepreneurial family. I myself have more than a PhD, but I did not get a PhD, which I chose not to do, but I have like 200 beyond my master's. So anyway, enough about me, and I'm not sure who I could follow up and speak to, whether it be the host Mr. Mooring or whomever. So
for sure, Michael, but I'd be very happy, James, with all the sensitivity and understanding of your concerns and the desire to protect your ideas, your innovations. But if you can drop me an email, I can share with you how, and not every lawyer is up to speed, most of them are not, but for us entrepreneurs who are creating new value, new ideas, is frequently the concept of so-called smart contract.
And protection. What is your email, if you don't mind? Yes.
I'm going to paste it in the chat right now.
Thank you. Because and your heritage is wonderful and inspiring. I think that your dad did, you know, if he created an industrial company like this, God bless you. It's a fantastic story. And if it can be now duplicated in the space economy, I think you would be a great legacy maker.
Yeah, he was written up in national magazines.
So. Yeah. Thanks, James. Yeah, let's connect as well if you're on LinkedIn. And yeah, that's a great story. And yeah, I think Eva's going to be a really good contact for you because I think she knows those people that you want to avoid probably.
Yes.
So what is her email address? I don't see it anywhere.
He just typed it in. Michael typed it in. It's eva@californiaspacecenter.com.
I don't see it on my. Okay, maybe I'll tell you what, I have to move it around a little bit. Okay.
Why don't you type in yours and we will send you an email or.
Okay. I can do that.
And I just connected with you on LinkedIn as well. And I sent her email in a message on LinkedIn.
Okay, great. So we are connected. Thanks, Mike. Mm-hmm.
All right, so you do have my information then. I sent you an email.
Okay. Thanks, James.
Okay, thank you for your opportunity, and I appreciate everything.
Thank you for joining us with an inspiring story. Looking forward.
So there, we have two James on the call tonight, and that was a happy coincidence because we got to hear James Watkins' story. We have... James number two, can you go ahead and say that?
Oh, wow, that's a special treat. Hello, James.
Hi, Eva, how are you doing?
Good, special.
Should I turn on my mic? I can turn on my video, so if you want, where's my video? Can you enable that?
James is in Istanbul, so it's really late there.
It's all right, I don't sleep.
Great to hear you, great to see you on this very special gathering.
Thank you. Let's see. Okay. I cannot turn on my video, can I?
Try now.
Okay, good. Hi, guys. How are you doing?
Good.
Oh, you look good at this late hour in Istanbul. And speaking of these cities, is exactly what you are focused on Earth.
Earth, yes. Well, we just want to start from the ground up and then go to the space, you know, afterwards. That's our objective, you know. Before we go to Mars, we just, let's say, clean up the planet first, you know, make it prosper and improve the technology and wisdom, then we can do everything else so easily. You know, our objective, you know, as you know, we talked about it, Eva, is to unite all citizens of Earth, right? So we are now moving, focusing onto that much more efficiently. You can check on our Ikoria website, ikoria.com, of course. We are forming the first United Citizens of Earth, Planetarian Singularity. It's not a country, it is called Planetarian Singularity because we remove the borders, right? We remove all kinds of discrimination, separation amongst people, and not only humans, but also we include all other species into citizenship. And so all species on Earth will become citizens of Earth, right? So we start from there, and then we start uniting under infrastructure. And To build the correct planetarian infrastructure, we do need to create Ikoria Earth Consortium, which will be uniting all 111 million scientists, engineers, visionaries, artists, architects, all subject matter experts, all the way to penguin experts, you know, to unite, you know, all these technologies together. And so, of course, we are now working on Ikoria Earth Constitution, the charter that's also in place. And the constitution will be rolled out on April 12th. Everything is in timeline. So we're also starting the funding process, which will go up to $2 trillion now. With 8 billion citizens uniting under one umbrella. And so all scientists are very excited actually to understand Ikoria first, because the principles are different. It's universal, it's not human. It's based on universal principles, based on fundamentals of, you know, existence and harmony. So it's starting a new era called harmonism. And with this funding process, also we're going to start our own Ikoria currency, Earth currency, and that will enable all citizens to get a certificate, and that certificate will give you privilege to become one of the top citizens. You know, kind of like NFT, non-fungible token, we can actually create a unique certificate for every citizen based on their level of citizenship. So like you want to be 1,000, first 1,000 citizen, you know, this is right now, that's what we're starting. The first 10 citizen will be $66 million each certificate. But that will be given later after first 1,000, and then we do next 100 and then next 10 citizen. So each one is very expensive. That might go up even more in value. So NFT will enable that, of course, but also we have level 5 citizenship, which will actually allow us to pay citizens $10,000 per month income. So you will get paid actually from level 5 if you register. We create actually a revenue model for citizens to, when they register, actually we will become 10 million right away with that money payment. The money coming from the upper levels, of course. So it's like rich paying for poor model in a way.
Yes.
So it's a better way for us to spread, you know, as far as citizenship. Then once we have the 8 billion citizens in place, then we will definitely conquer all the projects, because citizens will pay for the projects. All the projects, you know, any kind of project that you can imagine or dream of. We want to do anything we can even do beyond dreaming, literally. We want to create something we cannot even dream, a reality, right? And that can only be done through high-level technologies like Singularity Genesis Project we have, uses volumetric printing, which will create all the big cities we have in place, Ikoria Cube Space cities, 1,100 cities across the planet. Those cities will be, you know, volumetrically created with nanotechnology. You know, we have scientists for that, and lots of them. And but once we initiate the funding process, they will join right away. Anyway, no problem there. It's really all about gaining the trust. You know, trust is coming from scientists, coming from engineers, coming from consortium, coming from uniting together, and everything is ownerless. It's an open source project. And so no one owns Ikoria, it belongs to Earth. Okay, that's the bottom line.
Beautiful vision.
Yeah, it's a really big vision. Yeah, that's awesome.
Vision is big. Yeah, there's a lot of projects. There's more than 20 projects, including Earth Academy, Life Lab Health System, and transportation system called R-Space, where you don't live in the cities anymore. You live in the transportation system. Including space travel.
Yeah,
that's interesting.
You know,
I never.
James is a special friend and collaborator, and his vision is ambitious, but also charters a very, I would say, if you look at what James has created, it makes compelling sense that very quickly we find economic means to put new cities on the earth, driven because it's impossible to redo current cities that we have. The growth of the population is so dramatic that unless we find a way to create new cities built around ecology equation, not developers and construction equation, we are going to consume earth, including something that James is so special to talk about, animals, which are silent victims. And you talked about sea pirates, but the atrocity of treatment. And I think I want to recognize James by being bold enough to include animals as a rightfully so citizens of planet Earth. The challenge that James has is also something that I touch on, is his vision is so challenging, so unique, so compelling at the same time, that it takes special type of investors, financial supporters to jump in. And
We have already $2 trillion from citizens. I have a mathematical model. It's not that we have the money, but we can generate that money with confidence.
So he has algorithms.
Yeah, we can. It's not an issue actually. But we start from the first $1.5 billion funding, which is the first 1,100 citizens, and then we go up from there. And the first we have actually the document coming soon on how the funding will be extracted towards to other projects, like including communication platform, social platform, networking.
Yes. And James is also part of the California Space Center Quest and provided some incredible materials, graphics and conceptual
designs.
Because he understands my vision, I understand his. And I think we are showing an example of one entrepreneur helping another.
Yes.
To reinvent Earth and space.
We don't own anything. We shouldn't own anything. That's what we believe in, you know, because ownership is the main problem of everything. And the new design is harmonism. It's ownerless system. No one owns anything, then everything is yours. All right. Earth belongs to all of us, but Ecoria belongs to Earth. So anything we create belongs to Earth. No one can have any ownership right, so including IPs and any license and everything like
that. Thank you.
All right. When you don't own anything, you don't need money. All right. Yeah, there's more detail coming soon, so you'll be all excited and everything will be possible. And I'm very happy to work with Eva, of course. Hopefully we'll get to that next level.
We will get to the next level, yes.
Look, courage is afraid of us. You're not afraid of courage.
It's good to see. thanks for sticking around and waiting for us.
No problem. I'll see you again.
Yes.
Thank you.
See you, James. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Did you have any other questions for me?
I did. Oh, I like your sunglasses.
Yeah.
I decided to bring some entertainment factor. Those are my moon glasses. Silver coordinated. Next time I'm going to show you my Mars glasses.
Oh, nice.
Cool. Yeah, looking forward to it.
So
because space is beautiful, fashionable, in vogue, and full of beautiful music. By the way, Grant and I are working on composing the first true Mars music, because we received from NASA first sounds that came from Mars. And now we are building it into the first Mars hip-hop, and I am exploring with NASA if we can actually transmit our song back to Mars.
Oh, man, that's cool.
So how does that work?
Well, because the sounds and images are being transmitted from the rover Perseverance, which has four cameras, two microphones. We can receive on Earth. So I'm exploring if we have capacity to push up data to Mars through the same channel. So stay tuned. this is really going to be cool. And this is also why I'm developing a California Space Center hub called the Lady Rocket Mars in Pasadena, next to NASA JPL. I actually located an incredible building because, you know, we have NASA, they are doing those incredible things. They have NASA TV, but we don't have anything what we were talking about, which is taking all this incredibleness and transforming it into something fun and unique that people can kind of, you know, get interested in and have a place. You know what, there's no place in Los Angeles or Pasadena where we can experience space in a new way, not through the museum, not through the Museum of Science. They are there, they are doing a great job. I'm talking about what Lady Rocket brand stands for: engagement, emotions, entertainment. So I am getting some proposals on how to transform it, of course, virtual reality, fashion, concerts. So wish me good luck, because I have received incredible offer from the owners of this spectacular building in Pasadena, which used to be a place for selling clothes. And there is no place for Mars in Pasadena, so I want to change it.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah, we'd love to come.
Yes, you, exactly. Or even before you come, give me your ideas. How would you like to experience Mars? Because, you know, we're talking, our guest was talking about space camps. We don't have space camps in California.
Oh, wow.
I wanted to do one, and I did in Lompoc. And I had one during the actual, listen, this was my space camp. It was authentic because United Launch Alliance was launching rocket going to Mars on May 5th, 2018. And I had 50 kids gathered with me, organized to watch the Mars rocket launch. And then we had art events, fashion events. So I guess I would call it first Mars camp in California.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah. I went to space camp when I grew up, and it was a really good experience for me. And so, yeah, just it's kind of makes you a little sad to think that, you know, some kids might not have access to
this camp. Ready to pair.
And here is my complete moon media accessory.
Nice.
Because this is, you know, when you are, especially with young generation, you cannot look always serious. Have to have some flashy things to get the attention.
Is there anything else you want to talk about?
Yeah, if you want to. Earlier you were talking about payloads. Did you want to talk about that, or?
I can highlight a light part of the payload, which can completely change how Elon Musk shaped his business model. Because right now he makes money, and his payload consists of satellites or some scientific payload going to International Space Station. It is executed.
Device is ready to pair.
It is executed based on a very traditional business model and very cost-driven value proposition. And he pretty much, you know, you cannot squeeze more out of his rockets using this business model. Because I am Lady Rocket, because as I said, my mission is to bring much bigger money from outside of the space industry. I am teaming up on creating new type of payload that might take very little space, but Lady Rocket will be paid a lot for ushering not only physically the item to SpaceX, but most important, finding a context for it. And I will give you an example. I'm exploring with Hublot, which is one of the Louis Vuitton watches, a campaign where I would put Hublot watch inside of the rocket that would go to Mars with the question, what time is it on Mars? And create entire event, Hollywoodish type of event, concert around it. Tiffany wedding ring, Francis Coppola bottle of wine that was designed to honor his brother, astronomer and mathematician. So we are transforming kind of boring by now, cheap, no money making value proposition into something that I would establish prices for by charging based on the brand value created for one of the richest brands in the world who are sitting on billions of dollars in cash. And the best thing that they can come up with is to hire celebrities to show their watches in a traditional way. And now the Lady Rocket value proposition comes forward because I have a track record of spending everything I can on do good causes. So again, this will reinvent the definition of otherwise kind of, you know, old fashioned luxury goods. We cannot just have luxury goods in the world which is hungry and sick. We can tolerate luxury goods if they do something good for us, help build space economy, help us put money back to Earth. So that's, I would call it Lady Rocket School of Payload. And I already have space reserved on SpaceX and some other rockets. I'm in a very exciting stages of talking to the celebrities like LeBron's, like those brands, to include them in my show that is going to take off for the better reasons than just, you know, put another satellite in space. But I want to spend money on our own satellites for climate change also. I love satellites. I want to have our own private constellation of satellites.
That's sounds amazing. Great. Yeah. So we have CJ Kent, who Inara says he has a pretty cool project he's working on. CJ, is now a good time for you to talk about that?
Yeah, if I'm out live, there we go. Okay.
Oh. Hey, CJ.
Hello, Chris will do. And so, yeah, what my mission is in a way to bring Earth, to bring space back down to Earth. Uh-huh. So I want to build schools, innovation schools across the developing world. And so in space, you have a, you know, every spaceship, you require closed systems. You require closing the loop. If you don't recycle things, if you don't recycle your air, your water, your voyage won't be very long. Right. And if you want to go long term, you need all the regenerative life support. You need a whole biome. And these are all technologies and concepts that we need to embody more here on Earth. And so my small team and I, for the last 2 years, we've been developing a design for a campus and a program that works in the global south or the developing world, anywhere there's no winter. And there are schools that are small farms, experimental farms. And on the farm, the students, we don't charge any tuition. We feed our staff and students from the farm. They do all the science that you can do on the farm, which is a lot. There's a lot of possible mycology, agronomy, this kind of thing. And that farm and the school that's built around it, with as much closed loop technology as we have now, and of course more in the future, because space is bringing up all of these new innovations. So in a way, the farm is like a spacecraft. Once you build the school in this kind of a model, then not only does it allow the students to explore, but it allows these students who don't have an opportunity, you know, our motto is, creating opportunity through education innovation. And so it allows students to explore opportunities that they wouldn't have before. And in the developing world, one of the reasons why, the big reasons we set it in the developing world is demographics. Because you have a whole generation and generations to come that are locked in poverty. They're locked in generational poverty because there's no education, you know, parents can't afford to have their kids go and do extensive education. They've got to work. Mm-hmm. And so we give those kids, and it's 18 plus right now, so post-secondary, we give them a good five-year program in our model, and they get the chance to learn all the skills they need, not only practically now, because we give them a good grounding and a lot of practical project-based skills from, you know, management, everything you can learn on a farm, which is a ton of things. But we also have a systems and design thinking approach. So we're preparing them with our dual focus, Earth farms and space science, we're preparing them for, you know, in 10, 15 years, when these new industries, like you mentioned, Ava, you mentioned new context, you know, and old economics, they can't imagine. You know, I ran into this argument so many times in the last few months when I'm talking online, and they're saying, oh, there's no market for 100 tons to orbit. There's no market. Mm-hmm. Well, there wasn't 5 years ago or 10 years ago, because these markets are going to be built by what's happening, yes. You know? Mm-hmm. And a lot of people, you know, a lot of people, I think, see that the kind of, you know, workforce development, if you want to talk in infrastructure terms,
yes,
these kind of things have to happen internationally. And the developing world is so rich with it. To give you an example, our first country that we're looking at trying to do something is the Philippines. And that's because my wife, she's Filipina, so it all just fit. You know, sometimes things happen, fall into place. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And so in the Philippines, I recently just met a young fellow, and he's the co-founder of the Philippines branch of the Mars Society, the chapter of the Mars Society. And the amount of interest in space, the amount of passion for innovation that young people in the Philippines have is just amazing. Mm. And I'm positive. I mean, we can see the demographics for any of these countries that have large youth, you know, there are people just hungry with the right attitude, but no opportunity to be the next generation of innovators, you know? So it's like, if all of you are familiar with the story of Sri Ramanujan, the famous mathematician.
Microloans?
Well, yeah, so he, you know, he reached out, you know, and I guess it was the 1910s, and he reached out with revolutionary mathematics that he had developed in isolation, true genius. And if it wasn't for that one letter being opened by an academic, if it wasn't for that one opportunity that he, you know, reached out, then maybe we wouldn't have a whole branch of mathematics, you know? So that's the idea behind the schools, is it's a way that we can take relatively small investment, because it's a small farm, if you can imagine a 1 hectare, right? And then that farm has on it, as I mentioned, it prepares the meals for the students and the staff. It feeds them. It has a little bit of a cafe. So there's a restaurant there. And the students work this whole vertically integrated food system. So it teaches them everything you can imagine in the food system. It teaches them, you know, if they want to innovate, we're going to work in like robotics. We're going to have them work on different automation systems. It teaches them, you know, product development, business development, teaches them just systems and design thinking, because we can have them do reviews of what's going on. And our program is, we have a saying called projects, not lectures. And so everything, this is where the real magic happens. Everything is documented with video. So the students, as they do projects, as they work and whatnot, they make video. Because now, you know, 10 years ago, the technology, the storage capacity for memory wouldn't allow this. But now it's so easy to vlog. It's so easy to stream. So the students make video. And all of these elements together allow enough of a revenue stream so that these schools can be self-sufficient. So again, it's like a little spaceship, right?
Yes.
Now the name, now that you've got a little background for it, the acronym for the school describes it all. I'll tie it together for you. It's called SMART. Students doing media, art, and research projects in teams. So SMART. Uh-huh. And so that's the, in a nutshell.
So thank you so much for sharing something so special, so vital and important. And we, as a part of the California Space Center, which is designed now to provide a vessel, a platform for other people to plug in their projects. And our role would be to synchronize it with the land and location ownership, which is so important. And I cannot think about better place than California, then close to Los Angeles, then to Vandenberg Air Force Base, then my 100 acres that Lompoc tried to take away, but I am going back and not only getting this land, I am asking, here's a very interesting connection that I want to make. I am also asking the United States Air Force and United States Space Force to give me thousands of acres of land, which is sitting unused as a part of the huge Vandenberg Air Force Base, which I would like to open up and transform into the space city. And what you have described, the farm in a California climate, next door, across the street from the actual authentic rocket launch facility in an incredible country of California, with access to the capital. And what some of our, and I'm happy to that you mentioned also media and entertainment, because at the core center of my California Space Center is a daily space news, entertainment and film production, because we need to have it as a way to promote different understanding of space. So where, so I would be very happy to discuss possibility of plugging you in as one of the resident projects at California Space Center, and just, you know, identify as one of the projects that we would like to implement, and then take it to the places, you know, to Bangladesh. You know, I am very concerned with Africa, but, you know, Philippines, Bangladesh. And there is, you know, the reason that I am forming this more structured funding system that is also transparent and open because of blockchain technology, which means that we are a safe vessel for money, because blockchain forces integrity, transparency, and consistency of spending money according to the principle. So I would love to, you know, discuss with you more of recognizing you and harnessing your ideas and plugging in into as a module for California Space Center Lompoc location, because it's also perfect. It's surrounded by the most beautiful wineries and agricultural land of California. Can you imagine?
Yes,
and
yes.
I always wanted to experiment with growing wine on Mars, because, you know, but you are touching on reinvention of the educational program also, how we educate kids.
Yeah, and practically.
The biggest investment goes into creation of the global media platform. So what's happening in the particular location is streamlined and shared globally to other locations while generating revenue streams that can feed the project. And the biggest money that you are making in the United States of America is, number one, if you are a startup, number two, if you have a platform, number three, if you are scalable, and number four, if you identify and you are solving huge problems that it takes billions of dollars to solve, but you found a faster way to do it. So I am kind of the economic operating system behind, you know, it all. So where are you located? Where are you?
Right now, I'm in Ottawa, Canada.
Oh my God, so this is why you are so nice. Canadians are wonderful people.
And well, you know, we do try. So
You are a gentler, kinder version of Americans. And
I know a lot of wonderful Americans too, so.
Well, yes, but sometimes we go crazy. And you guys kind of keep your, you know, your emotions and the even keel level. But anyway, so if Michael is and his wife are our, you know, the command control center here, so you are welcome to communicate with Mike and me in Wonderful. A follow-up. And just a last question, do you have like a preferred partner? What is your financial model? Whom do you want to have to help you put it together?
Well, we've only started, you know, we've been working on the design, myself, my wife, and my chief agronomist. We're a very small team, and wonderful volunteers have helped us out. for a few years, and we only started outreach once we were sure that the integration would work, you know, once we're sure we had something. Okay. And that was only about 3 or 4 weeks ago, you know.
I see.
And I met Inara by chance, and then actually, you know, she, because she's a networking genius, and so she lit a fire under me, and I've just been outreaching. So financial model, I am open. It's a challenge in Canada, because I would start a charity here or a foundation, but it takes 2 or 3 years.
Yeah, no, you cannot.
It's just not practical, you know.
So this and because I have a built-in capital, I just need to commit myself to a particular project and be willing to take it. Eric is still with us in Mississippi. I think Mississippi is a perfect location to bring it in.
And let me tell you something. Let me show you how this is all coming together. Right now, I am here. Me and my wife, we've flown to Miami, Florida. We're part of a consortium. And this consortium, we have the most, tomorrow we're going to view our 2 greenhouses. We're the only 2 greenhouses in the United States. They're the most technologically advanced greenhouses that come from Spain. And I think around 50% of Europe's produce is produced in these type of greenhouses. So one greenhouse can, like a 1 acre greenhouse, it can produce like 8 to 10 acres of, you know, production a year. So I get to see them tomorrow for the first time. Now another, and so, you know, you might have that connection, you know, with this, but I'm gonna have to introduce them to you guys. And then another thing on fundraising, I know Lady Rocket probably has plenty of ways to fundraise, but I am a part of something that takes it takes a part of the gaming industry. So, you know, the gaming industry is like, it's just growing and growing and growing. So it's called EACL. So pretty much a nonprofit organization can take part of this, and then off of those proceeds from the gaming industry, they can make, you know, make money off of it. So this is another disruptor, you know, in fundraising. So all this stuff is coming together all at once, and CJ, man, what you're doing is awesome. So I'm just happy to be in this space with all of you guys.
Thank you so much, Eric. So CJ, if you want to again reconnect and send a brief, and as I am finalizing my updated California Space Center plan to take to Lompoc geographically, but I am dealing with governor of California and others. I am taking city of Lompoc out of the decision-making process. I can plug you into our projects to be implemented. Of course, we'll have to discuss. And you know, the beauty of it is one of the investors in California Space Center in Lompoc is a 22-year-old experienced high-class educator from Lompoc, who is a graduate of UC Santa Barbara, and she developed with me also very special curriculum based on NASA JPL Mars educational program that we recalibrated to kind of bring it down to the level of Hispanic Black youth who doesn't have a benefit of having hands-on STEM type of experience, which holds back so many talented kids. And, you know, before we, in Mississippi, Eric introduced Mississippi to me, and it reminded me Mississippi has the largest in the world rocket testing facility on the river of Mississippi. It looks like a majestic space city. And no one knows about it. There's a beautiful land around it. So the sky is the limit. And the time to go and get the funding is now.
I'm 100% in. So, and I, you know, going back to an earlier point that you made as well, this really parallels our thinking, is that in terms of transparency, you know, you mentioned the blockchain and whatnot, media, especially the newer trends in media where people are looking for genuine media. They're looking for You know, it goes back to relationship marketing. It goes back to why streams and long form podcasts are so popular. And that also, that in addition to being a great new media segment, well, new, what's new is old, what's old is new again, you know? But in addition to being really genuine, the kind of media you can generate by documenting things and have the students interacting is also an excellent proof of transparency. Because yes. Anyone who wants, you know, anyone who has a brand deal or anyone who interested in corporate social responsibility, anyone who wants some sponsorship visibility, they know they're getting more than just PR. Because you can see the students benefiting, you can see things happening. And on, you know, if it comes back to the student situation as well, this is why we really focus on projects, not lectures, is, you know, you can't keep the students forever. You want to prepare the students, get them ready so that they can fly.
Yes.
But after a practical program, they can go and they can turn around to any employer and they can say, look at what I did.
Yes.
You know, look at the thing I developed, the team I was with, and, you know, I know how to do agile, I know how to do scrum, I know how to do project management, you know, and so, okay, I don't have a fancy degree, I have actual skills to offer you.
Right, right.
You know.
It's great. And Sadia, being from Bangladesh, I am sure she would have also some great ideas on how we Canadians and Americans can use space to enrich faster and better new generation of young people who don't have the time or resources to go to the traditional Stanford, Harvard, Yale type of a path. I think this is not good enough to go to the traditional universities. We have to create this type of parallel.
Yeah.
CJ.
So I think your idea is brilliant. And what I don't think you said this, but the applications of your program would mean you could raise a farm in Mars. Basically, that's what you're doing. So
that's right. Closed systems.
That's not going to happen immediately. So like once you have that program set up, these children will have these skills to do that and employers will love that.
Yeah.
So,
Chris, do you know about astronaut analogs programs?
Yes.
Yes. In fact, we have I couldn't put everything in our roadmap. On our website, we have a development roadmap. Mm-hmm. And obviously you have to leave some things out. But what we wanted to do was we wanted to do a space mission analog. And so it's definitely very possible, you know, in space, we're going to be using very similar technologies. So we're going to be using aeroponics, aquaponics, this kind of thing. But also, even if we don't apply that, we're going to be using agriculture optimized for volume, right? So, you know, our basic planting, even the outdoor planting, is something called a food forest. And, you know, if you imagine a tropical forest, there's life all through the volume, the canopy, the mid-range, the floor, the roots, right? And in space, we're going to have to volume optimize. Now, the reason a lot of people don't grow things like that right now is because agriculture is labor optimized. One farmer on a tractor with industrial chemistry can do hundreds of fields, right? But it doesn't really work out that well for the land, for the environment, this kind of thing. But if you turn it around, and people are starting to do this indoor farming, vertical farming, if you now with new technology and a little bit of awareness of what's going on, you can optimize, and automation, robotics, you can optimize for that volume. And in the tropics, it works. You know, in the tropics, you've got or the subtropics, or even like something like California, which is, I think, it's like climate 9, which is a very warm climate. So, yeah, it should work. Yeah.
Wonderful. Yeah. Well, I hope that you guys are keeping track of all those wonderful ideas, proposal, initiatives that your show has generated. that, you know, between everything that we discussed, I see a $1 billion potential like nothing, because, you know, but I am serious that I think that we have attracted incredible participants, and there is an opportunity to create a follow-up meaningful, because I think it became not only talk and a discussion, but actionable new initiatives that I think it's under our control to take the next step, you know, and that's beautiful. Yeah. It's under our control to start new, new space ventures, you know, even. You guys can become now new space bankers or participants. Yeah, your show can extend itself to be also an incubator for something like that.
Yeah, we're actually working on something like that behind the scenes with some partners here in the city, but we can't say anything about it right now.
And Sadia, you made me look up Bangladesh, and has a wonderful space program.
Yeah, I was going to say more about it. Actually, CJ, Bangladesh has a lot of underprivileged children. So
your and women.
Program, yeah, and women too. So your program would, you know, do wonders to the livelihood of these people.
One of the things too that, you know, we believe in very much is open source. And so, obviously we could do things, you know, like if we're producing some intellectual property, this kind of thing, there's brand deals, this kind of thing. But for the base things that the students produce, so the designs they do, the recipes they make, the video that they put out, we want it to be available. And for our blueprints, it doesn't cost us anything to open source design blueprints, to open source engineering information. So when we put a building up or we design a system, we want other people to use it. You know, we want them. So there's, you know, we looked at two kinds of scaling. One, of course, is building more properties. You know, we're building schools. Mm-hmm. So you can physically scale, and we did everything we can to make it a scalable system, very easy to build new campuses. But the other, the bigger one, is emulation scaling. And so when you have people emulating you and DIYing your systems, you know, we're looking at appropriate technology, something that is not dependent on international supply chains, very specialist, you know. There's no Apple computers at the heart of everything that you have to bring back to the Apple shop, because in the developing world, there is no Apple shop, right? So it's all appropriate technology. And so if someone in Bangladesh or India, anywhere there's no winter, because we just couldn't get around winter, you know, anywhere there's no winter, people can take these designs, adapt them. And, you know, we're thrilled because it helps more people.
So it's like a open source franchise, and you're talking about people being able to fork it kind of. And
Yeah, that's it. And I mean, as you know, and open source, there's business possibilities. Now, obviously we haven't done, you know, there's a lot of due diligence that needs to be done for specific deals and whatnot. And we're a small team that just finished the initial design. But definitely, you know, as we see in the software world, like Red Hat, Linux, is the classic open source success story. Mm-hmm. And there's good business models behind it.
And, you know, open source has been at my core, because as one of the early innovators in Silicon Valley, I achieved my first big American success in Silicon Valley in 1980s. So I was at the table when the open systems were created. First open system of sorts was also Unix. And this is the technology I was responsible for taking from the heart of companies like Hewlett Packard and transplanting this heart into the body of Boeing. And one of the, you know, the opportunity was a power of open system, and then Red Hat, and, you know, you might remember Santa Cruz operating system of sorts. But I designed my California Space Center, and this is why I was so appalled when Lompoc, whose city council had no embedded curiosity, even, because it's difficult of me to expect the city council will understand the virtues of virtual reality or transparent funding, but goodwill to understand, because everything that you are talking about in some form, not exactly what you have, because it's your unique idea, but I have embedded it in California Space Center, which on my shoulders, I carried five biggest American corporations to build it with me. And I was just blindsided by this little meek, irrelevant city council who, however, had a legal power to say, no, we are terminating negotiations. But anyway, I have to mention this story because I promised my constituency that I will talk about it. But anyway, going to your great idea, here an open system. There's another special person that shared with me that he's an open system person. It's Elon Musk. And on those principles, when I and my son Grant discussed with him a virtues of my mission, Copernic Space as open system for funding, he said, count me in because I want to open system. You are talking about your blueprints. He said, if Copernic Space move forwards and some other system, I want to open system my IP because I don't want to be the only one who manufactures rockets.
And he did with Tesla. He did the same thing with Tesla. Right. He offered to accelerate.
Right. But you see, there are no takers because it's a complexity of transferring of IP is based on current legal systems, old-fashioned patenting, implementation methods is prohibitive. This is why Copernic Space is going to be the $1 trillion company, because we have optimized the process and make it almost automatic and protected without lawyers based on the integrity of smart contracts. This is, ladies and gentlemen, this is a $1 trillion discussion we are having here. So I guess I've said everything. I have a strength and power to share. I just want to say one more thing about Bangladesh space program. And you probably know it, but I am so excited because they define it so well, so relevant also to you, CJ. The name is, it's almost like Italian name, Sparso, because it stands for Bangladesh Space Research and the Remote Sensing Organization. So if you allow me, I'm just going to quote here. So Sparso has been applying peacefully, beautiful statement, applying peacefully space and remote sensing technology in the field of agriculture, forestry, fisheries, geology, cartography, water resources, land use, weather, environment, geography, oceanography, science, education, science-based knowledge, and other relevant space research areas. What a beautiful mission. And they listed so much about Earth. So they are much more focused on Earth than as compared to NASA, who is focused on exploration of space. So I think Bangladesh has worked out this beautiful Earth-centric space model. So just like you, CJ, we're talking bringing space to Earth. And this is what Bangladesh is also doing.
And the awareness, you know, yes, because most people aren't aware, you know.
So I am sold on Bangladesh big time. And thank you for, you know, discovering that you are from Bangladesh. And, you know, this is such a sadia. Yeah, a special space program.
I have a degree in biochem and physics. So like when you said all those different disciplines, it made me really happy because as a scientist, I like learning, and so I appreciate it a lot.
So if I can suggest an action item for you, Sadia, if you will agree, send a note to your space agency that we had this meeting, and because of your heritage, we started to talk and became familiar with their incredible space program focused on Earth, and that we want to recognize them and maybe invite them to speak at some point in the future. I think it would be great to have someone from Bangladesh speak with us.
Yeah, maybe.
Listen, I am so delighted. Thank you for having this wonderful event, but it's late where you are, and I have to take off for another planet in about 10 minutes. So maybe we can conclude this wonderful gathering with my great appreciation to all the participants and two of you.
Yeah, this has been a great roundtable. I'm so glad that we all got to connect. Mm-hmm. And New Space, it tends to be like that. Like before COVID, it would be like a table of people. And, you know, we wouldn't try to get these big events, but it always ended up being like a roundtable of people, and the connections were always just, you know, worth so much. So we're very grateful that everyone was able to spend some time with us tonight. We hope everyone can connect offline. We recorded this talk, and you guys can see everyone that, if you didn't catch anyone's LinkedIn, you can see everyone that RSVP'd to the event on LinkedIn. So that's another way to find them. Yeah, we hope everyone's able to get in touch after the call, and everyone has a great weekend. Thanks, Eva, for the great talk. Yeah.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much.
Awesome. Thank you, guys. See you soon somehow. So looking forward to connecting with you. Mm-hmm. And Eric will talk.
Yes.
I think he'll be talking, my God.
Definitely.
We have to just identify how money will be allocated within, you know, Mississippi. And I know that you have a good footing on it. So anyway, thank you, everybody who spent the time with us, with me, and bringing to the table such incredible wealth of ideas and projects.
Yep.
Let's be better on Earth before we go to Mars.
Yep.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Good night.
Bye.
Good night.
Thank you.